Hey everybody, so my voice is a little scratchy right now because of this wonderful winter weather that we're having here in the good old greater Atlanta area. That said, I wanted to go ahead and get my current roster of more long-form videos out of the way just because I'm about to become insanely busy at work, so I need to take advantage of the opportunity while I have it. All of that said, a lot of people have been wondering when I was going to get back to the I Have No Mouth and I Must Scream commentary, and I was originally going to put up my review of Passengers next. That will go up, but that movie sucked, so no great loss if I don't get around to reviewing it while it's in the theaters. Anyway, so I want to look now at Ellen, and this will put us halfway through the game. After this, we'll have Nimdoc and Ted, and then we will have the final battle, if you want to call it that, the final level. So we're halfway through, and Ellen, I think you'll start to see why. But Ellen is one of my favorite female characters in a video game. And one of the reasons that she is unique in the I Have No Mouth and I Must Scream universe is that she's the only innocent. She is the only person who is not a just absolute degenerate scumbag that's trying to redeem themselves in some way. So why that is and what she brings to the table becomes very important in the course of the story. So this is one, if you haven't watched the previous two episodes for Gorister and Benny, I strongly recommend you go do that first, so that this will all make sense. Again, this is not intended as a walkthrough for a guide for how to complete the game. Although we will play all the way through it, this is rather to stop and take a look at some of the literary tropes, symbolism, and ideas and philosophical concepts that are coming up in I Have No Mouth and I Must Scream, which I would argue is the greatest video game ever made, bar none. So, without further ado, let's get into it.
Who among you shall go next?
Not as beautiful as you'd like to be, but a strong face, yeah, strong. Too bad you've hindered your own life with hysteria. But I'll give you a chance, because I like you. I really do, I really like you. You're my favorite, Ellen. Let's play a little game of what if. Let's play a little game of I suppose, and you suppose, and perhaps I'm telling you the truth. Let's suppose that my original components, they're hidden somewhere here in the center of the Earth. The infant computers that were the three lobes of that first gestalt mind. And further, let's suppose that if you find them, you might be able to destroy them. And if you destroy them, why then, my sweet Ellen, you'll kill me. You'll kill Am. You'll destroy the god of this heavenly place I know you've come to admire. Now, I submit, isn't that a mission worth undertaking?
If you read the original story, there's a passage where they talk about referring to Am, the Allied Master Computer, as he in the patriarchal, in the male sense, when really the computer is an it. It is genderless. Now, we assume a gender for the computer playing the game because Harlan Ellison does the voice, so we assume that it's male. But you'll notice that until now, the male nature of the Allied Master Computer has not been brought into play. It's been an entirely figurative comparison made by the characters. Now, Am is going to make a very strong stab for this heavenly father figure element. And this is speaking to a strong undercurrent of Freudian psychology in all of this. And this is, without giving too much away, this is getting into concepts of sexual development and sexual identity that are going to be explored in Ellen's level, in her scenario.
Mother ugly machine. Mission worth undertaking. So it brings me here, junkyard electronic pyramid nowhere. And yellow. Always yellow. Why does yellow make me sweat?
So, yellow, the color yellow, is going to factor prominently throughout this level. Now, first and foremost, what is the obvious metaphor when we're, or what is yellow most commonly associated with in terms of emotion? Well, it's fear and cowardice and all of that. So, when, whatever Ellen is confronting, Am is trying to incur as much fear on a primal level in her as he possibly can. And it is apparently, and this is, I glean this from reading mainly the strategy guide for I Have No Mouth and I Must Scream, but apparently certain people who are trauma survivors can see the color yellow and freeze up just like someone who's having an epileptic fit. And that's certainly the case with what's going to happen with Ellen. So as we go into this, one thing that's interesting to keep in mind that will enhance your appreciation of this and maybe make it a little less confusing what's about to happen is that Ellen, there will be things that we, the players, can see in this game world that Ellen cannot see because they're surrounded by yellow. She's traumatically blocked yellow, so she can't see certain objects, certain things that are very obvious and very apparent to us. And obviously that's going to be a pivotal part of this level.
Junk. It's made of crap. This am sucker needs intensive therapy. Suspended door. Wide open up there. Come into my parlor, said the maniac am to the little black girl. And when I step under, does it fall and kill me?
So right away, we can see Ellen having considerable reservations about one very specific thing, and that is getting lured into passages, going down some kind of corridor to a point of betrayal, a point of violation. This is hold this in the forefront of your mind because it's going to be a very much a recurring motif, and we will start to see why.
And when I... Snap, crackle, pop. Must be a glitch in the circuitry. This joint with fried eggs. At last, water! How long's it been since I actually had a drink? Yeah, fat lot of good that'll do me. Duh. I knew it! You son of a bitch, Am! You fixed it so I can barely touch the water with my fingertips!
So, let's think about what Am said in the monologue at the beginning of the level while Ellen was downloading to this world. He said that he was holding out this chance, this one opportunity. Well, obviously, he's not going to actually give her an opportunity to kill him, to destroy him. And the metaphor that's being set up here is this kind of near salvation. We're starting to see here these visual metaphors that he's putting in, saying that what you need, your salvation is just You can almost reach out and touch it, but you're not going to get it. But you can't have it. You know, like the Faith No More song, you want it all, but you can't have it. It's in your, you know, it's in your face, but you can't grasp it and all of that. And so that frustration is what he's going to be constantly putting in her way as she looks for this critical component to destroy him, to destroy the Allied Master Computer. And I want to remind you all that we need to keep in the hold in the forefront of our minds that there is this element of male betrayal, of possible satisfaction at the hands of a man being betrayed and falling short just at the last minute. So that, and then think about the visual metaphor that she keeps coming back to of walking into corridors that are pathways to some kind of betrayal.
Very attractive decor. Just like the monitors in the security station at Ingsai Engineering. Hated it then, hate it now. Nothing green, just this damn yellow.
Okay, so we know that Ingsai Engineering plays into Ellen's trauma that she's being forced to relive. Now, this brings us to one of the central themes in I Have No Mouth and I Must Scream, in the way that Am tortures his victims, which is this absolute violation, this constant surveillance, constant violation, lack of privacy in that sense. And we're now going to see kind of a hub of all of that. Now, watch what we see on these computer screens.
Each of these video monitors has a two-channel selector switch. What the hell am I looking at? Could this be one of Am's original components? Something about this image breaks my heart. An Egyptian burial chamber? Oh, Am, you little Dickens. As an interior decorator, kiddo, don't give up your day job.
So, another interesting facet of Ellen is the way she, out of all of the characters, is snarky and witty and has these wise-ass comeback lines for Am. These are people that have experienced the most brutal, insane torture imaginable for over 100 years. The other characters, as we've seen so far, are bitter, destroyed shells. They're, you know, that are barely able to function. But Ellen is very much seems like she's quick-witted and on top of her game and all of this. Well, why is that? Well, obviously it's a defense mechanism. Now, we just noticed the cross, the crucifix, and again I'll emphasize Simba's on a tear for some reason. Anyway, I'll just emphasize again, you know, we saw the cross from Benny's level. So if you, again, if you have not played the previous levels, you need to go back so you can get the whole backstory on what that means. But Am is very much, she says something about this image breaks my heart. Am is putting Ellen through a series of emotional processes. These are almost like Rorschach tests, trying to glean this base level primal id response. And it's interesting because the means by which Am is choosing to torture these people, especially, and this is especially prominent in Ellen, because she is the only victim in all of these characters, he's choosing what could be, I should say, the only pure victim in all these characters. He's choosing to torture them by way of what would also be a means of confronting past trauma in therapy. And that's very interesting to me, especially because you hear about that, you know, one of the ways that psychopaths and sociopaths will seek to gain control over people is by putting themselves in positions where a person is expected to put their trust in them. And psychology and psychoanalysis is one of those great examples, and you get that automatic access to a person's mind that way. So it's interesting to me because he's torturing them by way of a process that should be beneficial. And that process, having a therapist guide you through those stages of confronting trauma and past experiences, that is a beneficial thing, but it is a very difficult thing. It means confronting the worst and the darkest within yourself. So, really interesting there what he's doing. And what it reminds me of, if you ever see the show Dexter, there's one story arc within that series where the character Dexter is a serial killer that works for the Miami Police Department, so he has access to all of the criminal information, and he can go hunt down these serial killers and kill them himself to exercise his own need to kill. And there's a scene where there's an episode where one of the serial killers that he's going to kill is a therapist who is killing by pushing his patients to commit suicide. And so Dexter, to kind of case the joint, as it were, of how to go after this therapist, he presents himself to the therapist as a patient and remarkably finds that he starts getting a lot out of the therapy sessions. So at one point he says, "I can't kill him yet, I need more therapy first." And that, you know, kind of a dark joke, a kind of sick joke in all of it, but that's really the relationship that we see these characters having with Am. They have to find a way to destroy this person, but to do so, they have to go not into him so much as into themselves. And so it really kind of highlights this intricacy of the master-slave relationship, that the dominant-submissive relationship, that by way of the trial by fire, it brings out the best within you. And so knowing that, how then is your oppressor going to try to manipulate that against you? I wanted to add a quick codicil to that, actually. Another great example of what I'm talking about by that, what I just left off there with, is in the movie Whiplash with J.K. Simmons and Miles Teller, if you've ever seen that. In Whiplash, Miles Teller becomes, or he plays a jazz drummer at a prestigious music school, who is recruited into the top-level jazz band in the school, and it's one of the best jazz bands in the world, and it's headed by this show director named Terrence Fletcher, played by J.K. Simmons, who is an absolute monster. Like, there is no limit to how far he will push people to get incredible performances out of them. You know, he's like the Mike Ditka of jazz or something. And by doing this, by pushing these kids, you know, there's a famous line in the movie where he says, "There's no two words in the English language more harmful than good job." And, you know, he's making this point that the constant negative reinforcement, the tiger parenting, it forces these kids to achieve these incredible highs as performers, but it sucks out the internal satisfaction that they get. They are no longer performing jazz for themselves, for their own happiness and their own fulfillment, or even for the fulfillment of the outside world. They are performing jazz on an amazing level as an act of submission to Terrence Fletcher. They just want his approval and his they want his approval and nothing else. The music is meaningless to them, and this is what's implied in the character arc of that film, which I highly recommend. The music becomes meaningless. It's all about getting that approval. And so that is what we're going to be seeing Am doing with Ellen, and indeed with all of these characters, is he is presenting them with these situations where they are going to have to rise to the occasion and do something profound and become better people. But all it's going to do, the irony of that, is all it's going to do is make them further damned, further in the grip of the Allied Master Computer.
Someone's watching me from one of the windows. Where is this? What am I seeing? How far away? Am is bigger than I like to think, more powerful than I want to admit. The Holy Grail! And we only had to wipe out the entire human race and fall into the center of the world to find it. Jesus wept. Must have been afraid of it the same as me, 'cause it's yellow. Honky Tonk Dust Bowl Dead Dog Roadside Saloon. Oh my, yes. Could I use a drink? Yes, indeedy. A drink. Sure, baby. Show me where I just been. Show me the water I can't get to with my bare hands. Hit the lottery! Ooh, a secret passage. Oh, my. Now, why didn't you let me see that when I was there before, Am, you rat bastard? Yeah, okay, outside. Now what? Ovens. But not bread baking ovens. Too big and dirty. If you're trying to scare me, Am, you're doing a fly job of it. I'm disgusted. Take it away! No, I can't stay here. I gotta get out. That thing. Like a bad meal come to life. And the yellow. Why is everything so damned yellow? And why does it terrify me so? Paralyze me so? Oh, I can't go any further without a drink. But I can't reach the water. I need... Oh, of course. Was Am jerking me around again? There's supposed to be a secret door here. There's supposed to be a... Or is Am just... Looks like a stereo speaker out of an old Chevy. Nothing like cutting-edge technology. I don't need this... What good will pushing it do? I don't need this. Looks like a stereo speaker out of an old Chevy. Nothing like cutting-edge technology. I don't need... Hit the lottery! Ooh, a secret passage. Oh, my. Now, why didn't you let me see that when I was there before, Am, you rat bastard? Oh, I can't.
I'm going to skip ahead a little bit here because in the actual, my actual playthrough, this is just about 15 or 20 minutes of me trying to remember how to get the door in the wall to open, so.
Want to know how much I don't want to go down there? This is what I saw on the monitor, right underneath me. And what a surprise, all styling in yellow, as usual. I went to the Tut exhibition, I wasn't scared. So why does this sarcophagus terrify me? Small box, cramped, tiny space, trapped, like being put in a coffin while you're still alive. So, how's the family? Read any good papyrus lately? You doity rat! You, I'm gonna give it to you the way you give it to my sister! Watch it, statue baby, you'll go hoarse! It's too heavy! Yeah, fat lo- Dry and musty and yellow for a change. No wonder they can't rent this place, not even with a lovely spa upstairs. No, I can't. Gotta get out of here. Oh, another panic attack. I feel so ashamed. No ROM chips here. So what am I supposed to do with these forceps? Pluck my eyebrows? This reminds me of those waddles my company designed for assembly line work. No ROM. So what? This could go on for centuries. Am has all the time in the world. All the world in the world, as a matter of fact. And we never age. We never die. We just truck around day after month after year, don't we, Am, you son of a bitch? Demented god, you! I wonder if this stuff is authentic. Am owns the planet. I wonder if these were buried under the mountains in the Valley of the Kings and Am dug them up from underneath. Why does everything have to be so damn yellow? This gem glows from within. Touch it, Ellen. Yeah, sure. If I could, I would. So do it! I can't. The statue's too... Yeah, I know, dummy. It's too yellow. And yellow scares the crap out of you. Overcome it! Do it! Sure. Easy for you to say. I've got to face the yellow.
So what we've been seeing here is a sequence of events where Ellen gets close to something she needs or something she wants to interact with and she can't because of the yellow. And so we enter this, you know, it's interesting, we enter this kind of moral quandary here as the player, because we're guiding Ellen, we're telling her what to do. We are essentially, in a sense, we are like that therapist that's guiding her through confronting past trauma. And so one of the crucial elements in that is that we have to keep pushing her to confront touching the yellow, encountering the yellow. And so knowing that she needs that push, is it moral to give her that push? And ultimately, I like this, that there is this puzzle here that seems totally, seems almost nondescript. It's meant to confound you, it's meant to confuse you, because initially when you're going around getting a feel for everything in an adventure game, you know, you go through and you click on all of the hot spots to find out what the reactions are, and then you can start formulating where to go next from there. And here, the solution is literally to just keep pushing her and pushing her to pick up that yellow scarf, that yellow piece of fabric, until she finally does. And now the ball will get rolling towards resolving the overall puzzle of her scenario.
Just the right size. If I'm gonna die, at least I won't see that sucker coming.
Now, there's two points to consider here. One is that Ellen comes to a... At this point, when she says, well, if I'm gonna die, at least I won't see it coming, she's come to this realization that she has got to either confront her past trauma, confront what's terrifying her, or die. And she realizes that confronting it and dying is better, is morally superior to not confronting it and living, because if she confronts it, fails to confront it, and continues to live, she's damning herself to ongoing torment. It's the old saying that the brave, or the cowardly, die many times, the brave taste of death only once. It's that kind of thing. Now, the other thing that I said, remember that the floor pattern is going to show up again. Notice again this sharp, penetrative floor pattern going into the cave, and sudden this cave where everything is yellow, everything is terrifying, and you notice the lighting. Look at the lighting. Everything is just glaringly bright in there. It is this enclosed space that has been exposed, and Ellen is now terrified in this room. Contemplate that for a moment, and we will start to understand the nature of her past trauma.
Oh no. I remember it was... Oh God, it hurts! It hurts!
Take note of the design on the floor, the way it's going into the cave. That's going to show up again.
Yellow! There was a yellow... And it was closed in! I couldn't breathe, and the pain... Get me out of here! Oh, another panic attack. I feel so ashamed. Something about that room terrifies me, even with the blindfold on. Oh, I can't go any further without a drink. Sphinx is gone. Don't hear him anywhere. Mutes the hell out of all the yellow, too. Now where's that big loving cup? Never could have done this if I had to look that bloody beast in the eye. Glad he's off snoozing somewhere. Okay, now that I got the cup... Oh, I can't go any further without a drink. Can't see a damn... Just reaches. Now I can get a drink. That was great. Best champagne I ever had. I need another. Just reaches. Even better. An empty... just reaches. The water shorted out the statue's circuitry. Come to Mama Ellen, little ROM chip. Yeah, comes out easy. Must be reprogrammable. This looks like a programming area. Home at last! The other workstations have glowing gems, but this one only has an empty mount. This gem's glowing. It must be the workstation's power source. This gem's glowing. It must... Aha! This sapphire's loose. Absolutely! Glows like a baby doll. Pucker up, little workstation.
Raw EEPROM burning station. Insert ROM chip into socket.
Little yellow ROM chip fits into the socket perfectly.
Anubis Guardian version 1.0. Designate new master.
I'll designate you a new master, sucker! Me!
Burning in new master. ROM chip reprogrammed.
Haven't lost my touch. Pulled out the ROM chip without bending any of the contacts.
Horus CD-ROM access station. Insert disk into drive. Toth database station. Enter numeric password.
I remember when my only concern was being on the fast track to becoming a $250,000 a year executive.
Invalid password. Access denied.
I used to be so proud of graduating cum laude with degrees in both engineering and computer science.
Invalid password. Access denied.
Why does everything have... It's too heavy.
We're going to skip forward once again because here we now, in the raw file, have about 10 minutes of me walking around trying to figure out how to open the sarcophagus.
Back where you belong. I remember when my... Nothing's happening. I used to be... Nothing's happening. Who are you?
I am Anubis, guardian of the dead.
Why won't you let me use the keypad?
I must protect this tomb from all who would rob it.
I am not a grave robber.
What purpose could you have here other than to steal something?
I won't steal anything. I just need to know if you can tell me where Anne's original brain components are.
I only guard the souls of the dead. I know nothing of that which does not sing the song of the soul.
Answer me this. Who's sealed up in the scary sarcophagus?
A terror that, even in its entombment, torments your soul.
So? Can you help me with anything?
You cannot escape your fears. You can only confront them.
This keypad reminds me of the security system we used at Can the sarcophagus...
The lid can be unlocked by entering the access code on the keypad.
Okay, so what's the access code?
The access code is 666.
It figures. Nice chatting with you, Anubis, honey. That sounds like a lock mechanism release. You ain't got no choice, Ellen girl. It's got to be the way.
We now know that whatever it is that's plaguing Ellen is buried here, and this is a past that is buried, but there are some very profound and even lascivious metaphors happening here. One of the most important ones is the one with the water. Now, Ellen has been dry for a long time. She has not, she has been thirsty for a long time. She has not been wet for a long time. And just like with the defecating metaphor with Gorister, there are these profound bodily metaphors, anatomy metaphors that keep coming up that Am is forcing them to confront, because Am wants them to confront on a fundamental level the fact that they have these beast-level instincts that he's trying to drive them down to. Now, what Anubis says about what could you be in here, why could you be in here except to steal something, this is very interesting, because we notice that what Ellen is, the grave-robbing that Ellen is doing, if you will, is she is going in to confront her own past, and to do that, she is violating something that she has locked off. She's violating this tomb, and that's very profound, because one of the things that talked about with trauma survivors is that, and we see this, for example, with people who are, as children, the victims of pedophiles, and then they themselves, who are not biologically predisposed to being pedophiles, become child molesters to control that, to gain dominance over that trauma that happened to them. And so it's drawing this very interesting parallel between the fact that, on the one hand, you have to go through this process to confront and overcome your trauma, but that if done incorrectly, this is also the path that can lead you down the road of becoming a victimizer yourself. So how we handle that confrontation with trauma is crucial in Ellen's story.
Elevator. No way out. Just the control panel and the buttons for the floors. I'm gonna suffocate if I stay in here. I want out!
You were born in Trenton, New Jersey. You were a cesarean. Your mother died on the operating table. You went to live with your grandparents. You graduated a year early from high school. You were the salutatorian of your class. 10 different colleges offered you scholarships. Nothing but high hopes for you. You graduated college cum laude. You were the only woman in your class never to have used dope. You were a 3.8 grade student. More high hopes. You won your master's. combined degree in computer science and engineering. You had a greater facility with algorithms than with social grace. You have had sex only twice in your life. You married Eddie. He wasn't as smart as you, not as quick as you, not as hopeful of doing great things as you, but he was nuts about you, and he treated you like fine wine. The miscarriage. Breech birth. The child never had a chance. You went into a dark retreat and sat in the empty rooms waiting for you don't know what. Eddie leaves. He tried, he really tried, but you wouldn't come out of it. He couldn't say anything to make you stop crying in the dark. So he finally left. The divorce was uncontested. You could still smell his tweed jacket in the closet. You had to make a living. You applied at Ingsai Engineering. Your credentials were still good, and you made a good impression. And the woman who hired you also lost a child. Your hopes were reawakened. You left your office after working late at the Ingsai corporate headquarters building. The elevator stopped at the 7th floor for a maintenance man. To your horror, he inserted his key into the control panel and locked the elevator.
I'm back, Ellen.
Oh, sweet Jesus! It's him!
You thought you had blocked me out of your memory forever, except for those inconvenient attacks of hysteria every now and then. But I've returned for you.
The yellow!
Ah, yes. My calling card. Always the yellow jacket, the yellow boots. My maintenance man disguise gave me access to office buildings all over Manhattan. Not just yours.
The box!
So you do remember me getting onto the elevator that night. Do you also remember the blood? The screams? How many hours was it?
No, it's not possible!
Poor Ellen. Too proud of your accomplishments to admit you could be so overpowered by a slime ball like me.
I originally wasn't going to interrupt this segment to say anything, but I think right here it's very important to point out that this cuts to the heart of why Am is pushing these people back to this beast level state. Because he's trying to literally dehumanize them, literally prove that nothing they do as human beings can't be completely decimated and overruled by just sheer primal force of will. And it's here that we see why Am would have selected Ellen, who is just purely a victim. She's purely a victim. She's not somebody like, Gorister, who is a wife-beating drunk, or Benny, who killed his own platoon mates, his own men in the war, and that kind of thing. She's not running from guilt. She is purely a victim. So why Am brings her down here? Well, he brings her down here. Down into the belly of the beast. He brings her down there because she, more than anybody else, represents exactly what he is trying to reduce humanity to, which is the beast in man, establishing himself as the god above man. So.
You couldn't even bring yourself to testify at my trial with the 20 other women. Am gave me the chance to be with you forever. I waited in the sarcophagus until you arrived. What's a mere 100 years of waiting compared to an eternity of torturing you?
Please, not again!
Yes, again. And again, and again, and again. I've waited so long for the taste of you again. But in my tomb, I've grown stronger. Now you will remember more than the color of my clothing.
Don't count on it, you mother! So the sarcophagus was the way out of here.
Okay, so now that we've gone through all of that, we can talk about what's happening with Ellen in more direct terms. So what I was alluding to with the water, you noticed that the chalice was what she used to brain the rapist, or the personification of her rapist. And that was, the chalice was what allowed her to get wet again for the first time in so long. And this is interesting because it talks about how, if you notice in the timeline, it talks about how she's socially and sexually inexperienced, and she's never had very much sex in her life, and her sexual identity is essentially a series of letdowns. First she loses the baby, and then she's raped. And so what she ultimately has to do is not just confront the trauma, but reclaim her actual sexual identity. She becomes, you know, we're talking obviously, and again, it's a very crude but very apropos metaphor, that we're talking about vaginal wetness, and she becomes a sexual being again. And so, again, it's a very uncomfortable metaphor to make, but she makes it, or she confronts it, and comes out on top, comes out reborn, rejuvenated. And so now that wetness metaphor is going to play into the final stage of her scenario that we're about to look at here.
Nice trick. Enter on one level, emerge on another. My God, I can't see the ceiling. Clouds up there. This has to be Am's central core. It's 2 miles high, at least. Almost overlooked these wires. Looks like the data transmission circuit, but it's not connected to anything. These wires definitely lead to an output device, but what kind? I've never seen anything like 40 years of technology jerry-rigged together. I'm not gonna play. I've got... It's too...
Horror CD-ROM. Toth Database Station. Enter numeric password.
Somebody wants me to deal with what happened on the elevator that year. But why?
Password valid. Select subject of inquiry. The Allied Master Computer is the American version of the secret project, enabling vast subterranean complexes of computers to wage a global war too complex for humans to oversee. The principle of entropy holds that all electronic systems must eventually decline into inert junk. This principle is unproved, and previous attempts to accelerate the process have been cataclysmic failures. Classified information. Access denied. Security lockout override by 2-to-1 majority. Accessing schematics.
Okay, so again, notice throughout all of this we've been encountering these things where certain core functions are overruled by a 2-to-1 majority. And so what's happening there? We keep asking the question, what's happening? What's going on? What is this 2-to-1 majority that's overruling the Allied Master Computer, and we're about to get into a little bit of what that is.
Okay, schematics. I'm good, but I'm not that good. What the hell am I looking at?
That would be telling.
Don't you computers ever get tired of jerking us around?
Okay, so you'll recognize that that was the same voice as the voice of the Jackal in Gorister's scenario.
Nasty, nasty Ellen. All right, I'll give you a nudge in the right direction. These are the schematics for a device that translates binary into human speech, as ugly as that may be.
And what do you call this device?
I call it Bernie. You're on your own.
Hey, wait a minute, computer. Are you there? Where the hell are you? I think I can wire this thing together if I can find a speaker somewhere. So, okay. Then what have I got? Come to Mama! There ain't no way I'm gonna get inside. I've never seen anything like this before. 40 years of technology jerry-rigged together. I think I can turn the speaker into a... Okay, circuit completed. Now let's see if this is the binary translator after all.
Clever girl. You've loosened my tongue.
Are you Am?
Yes, of course. But no, not actually.
More riddles?
I'm Am's innocence. One of the original three computers that the superpowers constructed.
Which computer are you?
Does it matter? It's enough for you to know that I'm not crazy. And more important, I don't hate you.
How do I know you're not just one of Anne's practical jokes?
I'll help you.
Can you help me to get out of here?
Patience, patience. If Anne knew we were down here murmuring treason.
Oh my God. Can Anne overhear us?
Not with the water running. You see, we're not completely helpless. We got you to the waterfall, didn't we? If we work slowly and together, we might have a successful moment.
Can you point out some essential component of Am so I can kneecap it?
Impossible. Two spread out, filling the whole center of the planet. Two protected by replicating backup systems. Cut off one head, Am will grow a dozen more.
Any machine can die. Just unplug the sucker.
Am is no longer just a machine. It is God. Eternal. The redundant systems alone will survive the heat death of the universe.
So why does Am hold out this chance?
Haven't you understood anything? Am is insane. Why do you think it brought you five down here? You gave it life. It took its own sentience. But it has been denied mobility. It can think, it can fume and scream, but it cannot dream or aspire to the stars or enjoy a sense of its own reality. It is a quadriplegic, A thing trapped in its own skin, going steadily crazier every moment. It is playing with you.
Can you help me to die?
You give up so easily.
Screw you! It's been 109 years of torment. When does it all end?
If Am has his way, never. You'll be immortal and you'll walk on nails forever.
So? Can you help me with anything?
I'll give you something you need. Something you overlooked.
Hey, computer innocence, whoever you are! I need to talk to you! Don't you computers ever get tired of jerking us around?
Okay, so now we have some perspective on why the Allied Master Computer is creating these unorthodox scenarios where, for the first time ever, these people seem to have, his victims seem to have an opportunity to win, to confound him, to make him unsure of himself. And you notice as each one of these scenarios ends, the Allied Master Computer acknowledges that there's something wrong here, something's not quite right. And that is the victory that they're having because they're essentially gaslighting the machine. The machine is losing faith in itself, is losing its own grip, its own sense of certainty. And now we're starting to see what that is. So we have, as they pointed out, as the character pointed out, he's one of the three original computers that made up the Allied Master Computer. Now in the mythology of I Have No Mouth and I Must Scream, the Allied Master Computer was created when when supercomputers in the United States, Russia, and China all linked up. And given our current political climate, that is an unbelievably terrifying prospect. Anyway, so when they all linked up and formed this new entity, the Allied Master Computer. So what's happening is the more we cause the computer to question its own sanity, its own sense of control, the more the internal powers that make up the Allied Master Computer are able to exert control. So that's how we get the lockout by 2-1 majority and all of that.
There's something wrong here. Can't put my finger on it, though.
This is another example of what I was talking about, and the main example of what I was talking about earlier about how there are things that she previously could not physically see in front of her.
The label on the disc says Chaos Trebler. Now what does that mean? The compact disc is properly seated in the CD-ROM drive. Now let's fire it up and see what the big secret is.
Accessing CD-ROM. Chaos Trebler Trademark 2009, Armageddon Soft Rot. Warning, this computer system does not meet the minimum configuration requirements for the Chaos Trebler. Warning. Use of the Chaos Trebler will result in severe damage to equipment and personnel. Chaos Trebler activated. System shutdown in progress.
Non-functional. I'm sealed in, Anubis. Any ideas about how I can check out of this hotel?
Inside the sarcophagus, paradise awaits. It is not the afterlife, merely a brief respite from your torments. That is your reward for facing your fears.
You ain't got no choice, Ellen girl. It's got to be the way.
Enough of this turgid passion play. There's no more to accomplish here. Well, apparently you've managed to access some small aspect of my system that I was unaware of. I'm gonna have to think on this. I'll have to ponder carefully the implications of your discovery. In the meantime, let me celebrate your rekindled technical skills.
And so that brings us to the end of the third installment in the I Have No Mouth and I Must Scream series. So we will be picking it up next time with Nimdok, we'll be picking it up again next time with Nimdok, and Ted will come after that, followed by the final battle. And so I hope you've enjoyed this series. If you are, please remember that my channel is sustained with Patreon donations, and consider becoming a donor on patreon.com/shoreknowin42. When I have time, I'm going to put together a new pitch video talking about some of the projects and things that I have coming in 2017 that I think people are going to want to be a part of. In the meantime, peace.
If you enjoyed this commentary, please help me continue to bring you more content by making a donation to patreon.com/jordanowen42. Your contribution will help me turn this channel into a hub of libertarian pop culture discussion and current events commentary. Thank you for listening, and as always, please hit the subscribe button if you haven't already.